was about 3 months ago, if my memory serves me right, that I received an unusual gift from one of you. The gift of a little plant, a lemon tree. What do you call a little tree? A lemon tree left? I think it was bought from Lowe's, and it was in a flower pot. It was this tall. And they were actually twins. And so one, she kept it to herself, and the other one was given to me. It was still in the trunk. It was freshly bought from Lowe's. And I was asked immediately after the second service if I cared for lemon trees. And the sound of it, lemon tree, was so like inviting that I found myself saying, of course. And it was handed to me immediately. And I received it, and with one parting word, she said, I pray that you would care for the lemon tree well, Pastor, because I would care for mine. And I said immediately, of course, of course. Now the thing about that is because it's actually an important chapter in my life, because I had been told by a few relatives that our ancestors, the Diwa side of the family, were originally farm people from Zambales. They cared for wild horses. They sold horses, but they worked and tilled the land. They said that we the Diwa family, are organically based. Like they know how to plant. I noticed some unusual thing about my hands, that they're particularly warm in the daytime, really warm, excessively warm, as in some kind of feverish, but at nighttime they're unusually cold. I was told that my father, who loves to plant, it is very natural for him to grow plants, they grow. I'm also aware that there are people who, when they start attempting to plant, it's an exercise in futility. The plants die. Hence, there is a theory that there are actually people who are sort of, you know, they're very good with plants, the Green Town people. And I was told that I was one of those, although I have never had a chance. And so that was my chance. So I took it home, and because it was a lemon tree, I kind of like read up a little bit, some working knowledge on how to grow a tree. And I got it from some weird fanatic, that it is the most wonderful thing to grow a tree. But you have to understand that you really have nothing to do with it. Everything that needs for a tree to grow is already there, and the soil and everything. You don't have anything to do with it, but you have to facilitate it. Isn't that ironic? You don't have anything to do with it, but you have to make it conducive. You have to facilitate it. And so I was given some pointers. Be sure that the tree doesn't grow alone. Must have company. Must have another tree nearby. I said, what? Are they going to fellowship? Yeah, and then be sure that the proper amount of water, not too much, not too little. Be sure the element of sun, the sun, if there's no sun, be sure there is a substitute, like light, that goes into the plant. And be sure you touch the leaves, kind of like remove the dead ones, but when you touch the leaves, do it affectionately. Like massaging the leaves. And if you care, she went on to say, talk to them. That kind of like weirded me out. talking to the leaves. But I somehow noticed that those who are really good with roses, those who are really blooming, are kind of like, they kind of like talk to their plants. Did you notice the bushes there at the front? You know how luscious they are? You know who cares for them? Freddy from Ilocos, the green tongue guy who knows a lot about agriculture. Sometimes, you know, when he's pruning those, I catch him every now and then talking. And I don't tell him. I said, what in the world is this guy doing? He's talking. But anyway, I have a confession. Because it was my first project, I tried it. I did everything that I found in the site consistently. If you visit my home, I actually got another one, a difficult one to grow, bonsai, because I said, if I'm able to grow bonsai, then I'm a legitimate organic farmer. So I paired the lemon tree with the bonsai. See, if this bonsai will grow, let's see. You know what happened? After 3 months, for those of you who went to my Bible study last Friday, I showed you the muscles of those plants. It's incredible how now I need a new pot. Because it just grew. And then the giver of the lemon tree, your mother, Migo, your mother was the one who gave you, was kept asking how the lemon tree was. I said, well, you won't believe it. It has grown to about more than a foot. He said, get out of here, she said. No. I said, why? Because she said, mine died. I said, when was the funeral? You didn't even tell me. I said, well, the thing about this working knowledge is this. I attribute the thing that I Googled how to do this sort of thing, and I didn't merely process and kind of like kept it in my head, but immediately I set it to motion and precisely according to the specs, including the insane talking to the leaves. But I must confess to you that every now and then, although I don't believe that thing, I just kind of like found it interesting. That when I strike the leaves, I say, are you good today? Doesn't hurt, you know. It's kind of like a creature of God, you know, kind of like, are you good today? And, you know, they don't answer back, but just like my dogs, they don't answer back, they just look at you. But you know, something is probably happening there. So the working knowledge, but one thing I know, you cannot argue with me that Miss Lemon and Mr. Bonsai are as healthy as can be. You can't argue with me that I had nothing to do with that. But I was merely a facilitator of what's already in there. Now, Christian spirituality is very much like that. The Lord Jesus emphasizes in his disclosures, and you know, you're making this thing too complicated, because spiritual life is very organic. And that's the reason why when he normally introduces stuff about spirituality, it's more often than not about agriculture. Because I think Jesus is up to something. He's telling us that spiritual life is actually organic. You don't need to be sophisticated and, super scientific about this or things of that sort, because everything that is needed is very natural. You were crafted to grow according to my terms. If you only follow my terms, you will grow in fruitfulness, which is actually the main point of our existence. And so we are going to delve into the working knowledge of how you and I can develop spiritual muscles. And if you are not yet into the wonder of spiritual death, that today might just be the day that you'll say, my goodness, I'm in. I want to grow in not only my knowledge of Jesus, but I want to grow in my faith. And I want to start experiencing what these guys are telling me is even possible, like intimate fellowship with God. You know, working knowledge, the Greek word for knowledge, to know God, is ginosko. And you know the Greek for to know, ginosko, is this: to intimately grasp who God is, His mind, His heart. And then not only to know that, but to intimately experience the fullness of that presence in your life. Is that even ever possible? That your fellowship with God is going to be on that level? Well, today might just be the day that that will start, if it has not started yet. And so I'd like for you to turn to John 15:1-5. Some of my colleagues in ministry are so delighted with John 15 that I know of a pastor or pastors who actually have preached from John 15:1-5 the entire year. How'd you like for me to do that? Preach on this passage for the entire year. 1 year. Just John 15:1-5. I'm not going to do that. But we can do that if you want. Because this is so full of treasures. But from now, we will be dealing with the working knowledge. And the first thing that I'd like for you to note on this wonderful passage is the matter of sustenance. The matter of sustenance. When you say sustenance, it has something to do with nurturing, being sustained. Where are we deriving our gasoline, our fuel for our Christian life? Where is the primary fuel? Where is the primary push coming from, or the primary pull? Whatever you want to term it, sustenance, where is the center of our sustenance? Well, it says here in our text, agrarian, by the way. This is where the Lord Jesus introduces agriculture metaphor, a picture. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser, or the gardener. Did you get that? Immediately, the Lord Jesus, in trying to explain, hoping that we'll get it, He makes references to the vine. And in biblical literature, Old Testament and New, whenever the vine is mentioned, almost always it is in reference to the people of Israel. The people of Israel were God's chosen people originally with one purpose. God chose them to be a set apart people with only one purpose: to represent the perfect life. God said, I will set you apart and I will sustain you as a people in order for all the nations of the world to understand what life is all about and how it ought to be lived. You are going to be my representatives, Israel. You are the vine. That's what it is. Very interestingly, the Lord Jesus is making a radical declaration here. He is actually declaring that Israel, that He is replacing Israel, because He's saying, I am the true vine. Of course, Israel was disobedient and they can no longer be the representatives of God. You don't look to Israel as the model of God, as the model of the human life as designed by God. But Jesus is saying, you want to look at perfect human life? You want to look at perfect theology? Someone said that Jesus is perfect theology. And that is so apropos. You know why? Because you want to know God and you want to understand how life must be lived well, you go to Jesus. And that is the reason why Jesus is saying, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. He's the vine dresser. It flows from Him. And it goes to me through you. That's why I'm disclosing this to you, so that you know that if life's going to be lived well, it has to be sourced from me. I need to be the center of your life. And once you get it, there is no other movement but a movement outward. Life that is lived with God is not self-contained. It always moves to the second truth. It always bears substance. There is fruitfulness. You cannot say that you're a follower of Jesus if there is no substance to your faith. And the substance of Christian faith always has to do with fruitfulness. The outward manifestation of what is already happening inside. If Jesus is central in your life, and you get that, and Jesus is enthroned at the very center of your life, it has no other way of expression other than an outward manifestation of that truth. So much so that those who are around you, whether whatever affiliations they are, will not be able to resist the beauty of the kind of life that they see in you. Jesus shining through in your life. That is the substance. That is, in its basic, simple form, the substance of life. And by definition, what is substance? The primary essence of why you even exist. Or, to make it more simple, the purpose of your life. What's the purpose of your life? To bear fruit. And in simple terms, it is this: that another person is impacted by my life because Jesus is in me. Did you get that? Another person or persons is impacted. If there is no impact, you are missing the substance. You are in solitary confinement and you are probably joyless. Because I know of a lot of Christians who are in that field. Joyless. Now, you know, the problem with this is even played out clearly in this passage. It says, I am the vine, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off, did you see the language? He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, cuts off. While every branch that bears fruit, he prunes so that it will become more fruitful. Did you see the imagery? Again, I have to verify this with our onboard agricultural guy, Freddy. And he said, that is so true, Pastor. That is just on point. You know, I had to validate this with him, because it says here that, you know, the vine in Israel, there is a gardener and constantly looks at the vine and the branches, because they're supposed to bear fruit, the grapes, so that they can turn them into Brunelli or Moscato, you know, turn them into good wine, right? And so when they spot a vine branch that's bearing fruit, what they do? What do? They even more, they prune it. They prune it, and you know the process, you know. Once you cut this fruit-bearing branches, all the more they flourish. Yeah. But then, we are told in scriptures, the Lord Jesus himself says, but if the vine dresser spots a branch that's not bearing fruit, he cuts it. Now this is very tricky. If you search the Greek lexicon, you will discover that this is a very tricky Bible passage, because there are some teachers who will teach you that this is an argument that if you are not bearing fruit as a Christian, you will lose your salvation. Jesus will cut you off, right? Yeah. That's wrong. Because that's not what the passage says. We know from scriptures that if you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're guaranteed your seal. You will never lose your salvation. Never. No one can snatch you away from the Father's hand. Even if you backslide, you will not. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. But something is going to happen. You will be cut off. Huh? Well, the Greek word for cut off is aire, which is to air it. So the gardener, when he looks around and he sees a branch that's not bearing fruit in the Middle East, you know what they do? They will pull the branch up from the ground and air it. That's like cutting it off from the ground. They will air it and hang it. You know what Freddy told me? That's what we do in the locals. When a branch is not fruitful, we lift it up and air it for a season and wait for it to be freed from all the malignancy. Maybe in a year or two, it will start bearing fruit. But it has to be aired up. It has to be benched. Huh? Do you know of some Christians who are currently benched? They're not producing. They're cut off. Do you know? I was once benched. I was once an unproductive Christian. You know why? I was obsessed with myself. And so if you ask me on a given year, have I shared the gospel? Have I impacted one person? I probably would tell you, no. I was being aired. You know what happened to the nation of Israel now? It's cut off. But there's a promise in the Roman, in the book of Romans that one day, all Israel will be saved. One day, the nation of Israel will be brought back to the ground and it will bear fruit. In the book of Revelation. So did you get that thing? So what's happening here is what Jesus is trying to tell us is the mark of substance is this. That your life actually impacts the life of another person. And that can only happen if the sustaining center of your life is Jesus. There is no way around it. It's either you are impacting lives around you or you're not. If you are not impacting lives around you, you are being aired out today. Sorry to say, but you're living a useless life. But God loves you. He's not going to chop you out. He's going to air you up so that one day you'll get it. And so that you'll understand that the joy of life has everything and all to do with allowing this little life of mine to impact another life. Did you see the organic nature of this? Jesus is saying, let's not get this too complicated. The reason why I created you is so that you can be my representative. I'm going to fuel your life. And once I fuel your life, I'm going to give you opportunities. I'm going to give you people around you and watch. It just happened to Gerald Reed. Gerald Reed, you called me just this week. And you were delightful. I hope you won't mind me sharing this. In the context of the hospital, three people went up to him and asked him questions about the faith. Gerald is kind of like, what in the world is happening? Why are these people coming to me? It was not even difficult because he just opened his mouth and began talking about the simplicity of what he believes. Did they argue? Probably, mildly. Did he argue back? No, he just went on explaining what he believes. Tell me, if that's not impacting people. See, I was at the gym yesterday, and there is this good-looking Latino guy who is so kind to me, who works there, who cleans the bathroom impeccably, so delightful young man, And he was yawning all the time, so I went up to him and I said, "Hey, friend, probably you need to sleep. Looks like you lack sleep." "Oh yes, I hardly slept because I took my girlfriend out to La La Land. And you know, it was a long night in the dark, coffee and everything." "Well, you have a girlfriend?" "I do. We've been living in for 4 years." I said, "What? We've been living together for 4 years." "You mean you live together?"
"Yeah."
"Well, you must be so in love," I said. "You must be so in love." "Well, you can say that. Do you love him?" And then he said, "I'm not sure." I said, "What? You're living in, but you're not sure that you love him? How about her? Is she sure?" "I have to ask her." "So are you actually live together, but you're not sure that you love each other? Why don't you marry her?" I said, "4 years together? You're not married?" "Well, you know, when you get married, you have to be so sure that she's the one." I said, "4 years, you're not yet sure?" "You know, I'm confused," he said. "I'm really confused. It's good that we started talking like this, because I'm really confused." I said, "Really, to be honest with you, maybe that's the reason why I'm sleepy." I said, "No," I said, "that's La La Land. That's what I call La La Land moment. You know, you are working now, and you get fired if we continue this conversation because the boss will not like it," I said. "But tell you what, can I get you coffee?" "Oh, I would wait for that." Chapter 1. You know, sometimes sharing the gospel does not mean that you share it right away. Look for those opportunities for a hook. Understand that sharing the gospel sometimes can be chapter 25 long. Right? Chapter 25. Yeah. And so the reason why we're afraid is because we think that we have to share right away. But as a matter of fact, what the Lord wants for us is to allow the others to see the brilliance and the beauty of Christ in our lives, and then we get the license to share because they see the beauty of Christ in us. Right? And that is the substance when we begin impacting people in our lives. The problem with this is, more often than not, I get calls from you. I'm not going to name people. And mind you, it's valid. I respect it. But I get calls from you. And while you're at work, it's a delightful call. I love to be called by you. But this is the substance of the call. "Pastor, good morning. You know, I have 3 friends here at work. And I think they're ripe for the gospel. Can you share the gospel with them?" I said, "Are they your friends?" And then he says, "Yes, we're very close." I said, "And you want me to share the gospel to them?" "Yes, I think they're very right." I said, "Why don't you share the gospel?" "No, you're better, Pastor." You see the disconnect there? The disconnect is God is giving you friends and circles of people around you so that you'll get the joy. Just ask the people who are impacting people here. Come on. Ask people who are constantly on the groove, impacting lives, and they'll disclose that that's where joy is. When the substance of your existence is engaged in full throttle, when you impact another person for Christ, that's where the joy is. That's the reason why Satan doesn't want this. Satan doesn't want for you to discover that. So Satan wants for you to be a spiritual recluse. All by myself. "I am a monk, Pastor. I just want to be alone in my Christianity. Come on, get out of here." You won't get joy that way. There is no such thing as a spiritual recluse. But try this. Try this. Impact. Use the opportunities and ask for it. A third thing that we find, it goes even deeper. My goodness, here it even gets better. Because what's this? The Lord wants for you to understand that the sustaining center is Jesus, and then the substance of your life is the external manifestation of what's already true inside. Because what you are offering the people is something that they will never be able to find anywhere but in Christ alone. What is that? Stability. This is what people are looking for, people. Stability. This is what the world is dying to have. Every career, every education is geared towards this, stability. I want stability in my life. And people, only the people of God have it. That's it. You have it. How? Here, it goes like this. Again, it goes. You are already, did you see that? You are already clean. You know what, how delicious that is? What Jesus is already saying, you got it already. You're covered. You are already clean. Because, he says, you are already clean because of something. Because of the word I have spoken to you. You know, when I say it, you can go to the bank with it. Because I said it. If you take me seriously, if you take the word of God seriously, and then you apply it, you're already clean. No branch can bear fruit. See? No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. So the language of remaining, or the language of abiding in Christ, is not a side commentary, but it is central in our existence. To remain in Christ. So what's the opposite? You know, some of the things that are difficult to process in Christian life can be best understood if you start thinking about the opposite. So what is the opposite of abiding in Christ? I was processing this and I began thinking, what is the opposite of abiding in Christ? Because I really want to understand what it means to remain in Christ. So what does it mean to be on the other opposite? So I began thinking, I know, rejecting Christ. When you have other gods. And then the more I thought about that, I was convinced that that's wrong. That's not the opposite of abiding. You know what the opposite of abiding is? Neglecting Christ, not rejecting. No one here in this church rejects Jesus. But I guarantee you, if I begin talking about neglecting Jesus, you know what's the language of neglect? You've been married to your spouse for 30 years, but you never bring her flowers anymore. Every day is an afterthought. You never tell her that she's lovely and she's beautiful. You love her, you love him, but there is neglect. And so the drama here is this. She weeps in the corner of the bed. She looks at you and says, "You've neglected me. The kids are more important than you. Your job is your mistress." The drama begins. You know what I'm talking about. That's the language of neglect. Right? That's the language of neglect. And Jesus falls in that category because Jesus is no longer central. He's just one of the good things in your life. Yeah? And that is, I think, can be backed by scriptures, because in the book of Revelation chapter 2, the first rebuke happened with an issue of neglect. How'd you like to be a member of a church founded by the Apostle Paul? Ah, so cool, right? The Church of Ephesus. I asked Voltaire, the cow who visited Ephesus, to take some pictures of the church of Ephesus. I think he did. He showed me some of the pics when he went there. And the Church of Ephesus was founded by Paul. Get this. When Paul left, he made sure Priscilla and Aquila took care of it. Big names, right? How'd you like to have a church with that pedigree? And not only that, they groomed Apollos to be their lead teaching pastor. After Apollos, guess who took over? John, the apostle. How'd you like to be a part of that church? How'd you like to be a part of a church in Acts 19 who said, because of Ephesus, they had a 2-year discipleship program? Tyrannus. All the people, they were waxing hot. They were chasing after heretics. They were doctrinally the most astute, the most keen. They had leadership training institutes that were rocking the city. That in Acts 19, we were told, listen people, if BCC is known for this, because of the biblical community church, the entire state of Texas heard the gospel. Are you going to be proud? You probably will, but that's not Ephesus. You know what happened to Ephesus in Acts 19? Because of the witness of the Ephesus church, the entire Asian region heard the gospel. How'd you like to be a part of that church? That was Ephesus. If you want testimony to this, read the book of Ephesians, because that's their thing. And they were hot. They even have a book to themselves. But you know what happened after 40 years? The Lord Jesus, who watches the churches, by the way, this is amazing. Don't ever think for a second that the Lord Jesus doesn't look at the church. His eyes are constantly upon the churches, especially on the leaders, especially on people like me. You know, the Greek word is holding it authoritatively. That's the word. He grips the leaders authoritatively. He whispers his will to them. And he holds them tight, making sure that his will gets done. That's the Greek word there. Something that's just forceful and frightening. That's what it is. So if you think for a second that your leaders, that your pastors are just going free-willing, we're not. We're not allowed to do that. If you can only be in my place. That's why some of you come up to me after my sermon and you kind of like mildly insinuate that I got into your diaries because it is so personal. Pastor, have you been reading my diary? Because it's like you snooped into my diary, because that's my problem. How did you know that? I said, I didn't know that. I just went to God and asked God what I need to pray for and what I need to preach. And then he tells me, he uploads the app and I preach it. And that's why you're hit hard. And then you say, I don't believe it. It's too personal. You have to believe that. Because that's how it works. When the Lord Jesus was observing all the churches, and guess what? He observed the church of Ephesians after 40 years. You know what happened? Jesus is saying, through John, you know, I commend you for your diligence. You're very good with social work. And you're good in chasing heretics. You're very good with doctrine. You know a lot about the Bible. But there is one thing that I take you up against you. You have forgotten your first love. You do an exegesis of what first love is. You know what it is? The centrality of Jesus in all spheres of what you do. When a church starts beginning to think, when a church, if you hear of any church that claims this, we are the church that everyone else needs to follow. Because we have found out this program is the program that really works. If you hear of one church that claims that, our discipleship program rocks and every one of you should follow. This is the mother of all discipleship programs. If you hear of one pastor who claims that we have found a formula, finally, for success in church growth, you know that they have drifted like the Ephesian church. Because in the book of Revelation, Jesus said, you know, you have forgotten your first love, you have removed Jesus from the center, and you have replaced it with programs and activities, which are all good, but they don't have any stability of any sort. Because the only manner, the only way that my church is going to be stable is if there is a fresh encounter with Jesus every single day. And how do you get a fresh encounter with your wife, Edison, every single day? By talking to her once a month. First encounter, baby. It's the first day of the month. Let's talk. Once a week, we'll do, right? Once a day, a minute a day. All day, he said. And I believe you. Because this marriage is on fire. I see it. Did you get that? How's your prayer life? Measure it. You know. Your communion with Jesus. In Jesus' name? Or is that the only time that you mention His name? When you're about to end your lunch prayer. Because you're about to eat food, that's it. Let's talk about the fight night. People, my dream as your pastor, I'm going to disclose it, is for the Wednesday prayer meeting. By the way, we don't call it prayer meeting. Do you know what we call it? Fight night. Fight night. Where's the post of that fight night, David? Is it still there? Huh? David threw it? It's somewhere? We have forgotten it, right? It's no longer there. It used to be. We're so gung-ho about the fight night. You know why? The fight night is delicious. You know, I'm a big brother to Tom, but I never had a big brother. You know how delicious it is for me to have a big brother who will contend for me? I've been longing for that. You know that there are bullies in my school, that I would have a big brother to tell him, big brother, I've been bullied at school. Who did that to you? Oh, I would crave for that. I never had it. I would go to Ate Sherry. I would look at her and say, Ate. And then she would look at me, oh! And I would say, never mind. So, well, God, why did you not give me a big brother? No one contends for me. And you know, my dad is so meek, you know. He's a lawyer, but he's so meek, you know. He's always kind of like playing chess. My dad. I wouldn't even go to my dad and tell him about the bullies, no. I'd be craving for a big brother. I'd be set, right? You know what happens at fight night? Someone contends for you. That's why Satan doesn't want for you to go to the prayer meeting. Because the moment you discover at prayer meeting someone contends for you, you will never stop going. And Satan will be shot. It was my goodness, they discovered it. Oh my goodness, you discovered it. Oh my goodness, we're done. We have no weapon against prayer, and someone's contending for him. Oh my goodness. Ask those who are attending regularly the prayer meeting, their track record on contention. They register. I'm not saying that once you pray for something, you're going to get exactly what you desire, because more often than not, it's the opposite. Because it's an issue of sanctification. You pray, you register, you allow God to do what He wants with that prayer request. And more often than not, it's not the way you want it done. Okay? Just want to be clear. This has nothing to do with the formula that you go to prayer meeting and you have 100% batting average. Everything you ask for is given the way exactly you want. Not that kind. What I'm telling you here, when you go to the prayer meeting, you register, someone contends for you, it's good as done. Your big brother fights for you. You never get that at home. That's why Satan is stopping you. No one does it in the Metroplex. You go to the prayer meetings of all major Christian churches, and their prayer meetings are at an all-time attendance low because the cohorts of Satan are so convincing that prayer meeting is irrelevant. I'm going to contend it is not. It is at the center point. I pray that the prayer meeting will outnumber the worship service. Because stability is when you commune with Jesus.
Amen.
Not only individually, but corporately. You want to try that. I want for you to bring your journal to the prayer meeting and test God on this. That's God. You want your life to be stable? Fight for Wednesday prayer meeting. Fight for it. Tell the people who are crowding it, tell them, I am meeting with the CEO of my life on Wednesday night. So please scratch that. I can't go to that meeting. I have an important meeting with my CEO because someone's going to contend for me. Or I will contend for another person. It's fight night. What? You're attending MMA? It's more than that. And then bring them in. I know this is crazy in North America to call you to prioritize Wednesday prayer meeting because it's insane from the standpoint of the world to do that. But I'm just going to say, because I feel strongly that practicality calls for something as organic as this. Don't complicate. Christian life is very simple. You got to pray with the saints, and then you will see signs and wonders that you've never seen before. And so how do we settle this? The church in Ephesus, after 200 years, before that, the church of Ephesus became the center of Eastern Christianity. All the bishops met there in AD 431. The third council, the third general council of all Christian churches met at the church of St. Mary. It was rocking the place. But after 200 years, the church of Ephesus disappeared from planet Earth because Jesus said, if you're going to remove me at the center and replace it with strategies and plans instead of me at the center, I'm making a promise. I will remove your church from planet Earth. Where is the great church of Ephesus, the one started by Paul? It's no longer there. You want proof? Go to Voltaire Kakal. He's going to show you the ruins. Let's not brag about BCC. Let's be on our knees that it will grow. In the centrality of Christ in our midst, three simple things for application. The first one is this. Let us be zealous in this world. Prioritize the study of God. If there is anything that you need to prioritize in your life, this, the intimacy of who God is and who are you in relation to God. Let that be the burning priority of your life. Let nothing crowd that. And how does that spell out? A commitment to serious study of the Word and commitment to prayer, both individual and corporate. Word and prayer, those two together. Number two, prioritize theology, but don't stop there. You practice theology. And be intentional. Whatever God tells you, make a commitment. There's going to be a practicum in this. I will practice it immediately. Bear fruit. Impact people around you. Thirdly, pursue. Remember, was used 219 times in scriptures so that you always make the connection and the time you were saved and the story of God in your life. I call Kokoy Reyes because this young buck here told me 4 years ago he feels strongly that he's called by God. I said, good, how did you know? And then he tells me, that's 4 years ago. It's a long time. And then he turns around. And then he discloses to me this year, that's it, Pastor, I cannot run away anymore. The calling has become stronger. I can't run anymore. I have to follow. I will surrender. I will serve the King. He wants me to pursue a full-time ministry. my doubts are gone. So Coco, I come here and I will ask you for a vote because we are required by the seminary where he's going to do that. He has applied to the seminary in the Philippines.
Wants to be cross-cultural.